So thanks to everybody. It's always something unpleasant to speak to a computer instead of facing people. But I'm very honored to have been invited to make this kind of introduction to this beautiful conference. It's even sort of strange moment because I will be 70 in 2 days, and a friend told me that the time for a kind of recapitulation, recalling all what we've made, and it gives the impression that we've always made the same thing from the beginning. I think I will make my presentation around a paradoxical theme. It would be something like music doesn't exist, which is a very sociological claim, but it would be, no, it's nothing but social codes. It's not at all the direction I give to this world. If I say music doesn't exist, it's not a minus characteristic, it's a plus. It doesn't exist because it has always to be done. It's always born again. It only exists if we make it exist more. So behind that, I think when I started my work in the C-suite, it was nearly 50 years ago then, the issue was very close to that, but about popular music. I'm retired, in a center that is called CSI, Centre de Sociologie d'Innovation, but that's the place where Calon and Latour later and John Lowe in England invented the ANT monster. And it's very connected to your conference, or our present conference, because the idea of actors and networks are in the center of your thematics. And it's precisely why I was hired first as a PhD student at the CSI to enlarge, in a sense, outside of purely technical or scientific stakes, this idea of ANT. And that is a strange word. In French, it was the sociologie de la traduction, the sociology of translation. And all the idea was on this passing things, no fixed point, but the things have always to be made through networking, producing their own agency, and so on. But it was in French, it was quite a loose word, and ANT, the Anglo-Saxon, and it became a kind of slogan. It's a strange slogan because it nearly says the opposite of what it tries to do. And it's not at all that we have the actors on a side and networks on the other, but on the contrary, that we have a kind of collective experience of things in the making that both realize what we are and produce things. So the idea was more to have one only word to say this strange thing, plus the problem of French, because we say acteur réseau, and we should say réseau acteur, which is the meaning of actor network. In fact, in English, the sense is always the opposite. It means that this mixing, heterogeneous mixture even of links and relationships, of multiple diverse relationships, make exist both things and us. What was very paradoxical in the case of science and technology, because of course it's solid, it's things themselves, was nearly obvious for music. So it was a kind of paradox. In the case of science and technology, the main purpose of researchers were to make them more social in a sense, that they're not purely objective. They are made to, even if it's a more basic physical things. But in the case of music, sociologists had exactly the opposite position. It was not even an object, just a sign or codes or symbols. And so the idea was 100% the opposite model. It was more to say something like, how do we project things, our identity? So the project in music was not to socialize it, as for science and technology, but on the contrary, to make the thing itself, if we can call it like that, appear. What does it mean to socially speak of music if we take seriously that some work in the both sense of the word, in French it's different, travail and œuvre, in English it's the same, but it's an interesting similitude, if I can say so. What's going on? What's the œuvre in cause when we play music? So maybe to frame a little my in a completely anachronistic way, my presentation. I like the word presentation because it's very close to the stake of my presentation precisely. Present. What does it mean that things are always not present, but to be made present? I think that's an excellent definition of music. So, I will try to rely on three authors that I didn't know well at the time and that progressively came. You know, this strange impression sometimes that you have sometimes when reading somebody that it's something you were looking for a long time. And these three authors will be William James, so the pragmatism, the American pragmatism of the early 20th century, but the sociologists have now given a lot of importance and reread and reused John Dewey, much less William James. But for music studies, I think James, even if he never talked about music, is much more accurate author than Dewey, in spite of the book on heart written by Dewey. Because in a sense, maybe it's a projection, I don't know what comes from my reading and what comes from what James really wrote, but it's exactly a philosophy sculptured for music. That is one of the main stake in James' strange pluralism and radical empirism, something that could be worded, there's nothing but the present. He was saying even when you say now, it's already past, which is true. But the poor interpretation of this presentism would be to oppose it to past, oppose it to the past. That's why James is interesting. It's because his present is nothing but a point on a kind of line of time. On the contrary, it's the full experience. What happens now? And what happens now it doesn't blow away the past. On the contrary, it's a kind of network of heterogeneous layers of realities. So that's its definition of pluralism, things that have nothing to do, but that deploy themselves in a sense, and we are gathering at the precise moment of the present. I think there's no better definition of music, even music of the past, of course. They are only there if we make them present again. So this is kind of a little too abstract presentation was to make this kind of recapitulation, active recapitulation of what I have done. So like in front of God at the end of a life, what have I done, or when we made a mistake. But it's more the same thing that I was saying about music that is in question here. How can I try to reenact my own project with this strange impression that often we have, that we always say the same thing? And my first inquiry, not by hazard, because I was studying classical music and musicology besides sociology at the Sorbonne in Paris, where they only still speak of classical music mostly. And it was both then the music I was playing, of course I was a fan of rock at that time, but as an object of study, I chose to understand what happens when popular music producers make a title become a hit. So the idea was, I wouldn't have said that in that words at all at the time, but it was exactly the question I was formulating in a more abstract way before. Okay, people speak of market on the side of money, business, they speak of taste, popular tastes, currents, and so on. And there is a music, poor guys that not even know how to play a guitar, but they are learning to sing at a whole 17 or 18 years old and making some rock music from Manchester. Well, now you have all these techniques too. I was forgetting a fourth name. At the time, it was much more simpler than today, but already the recording stuff and the studio were very important. And the simple idea of my first inquiry was to say, no, nothing that is kind of realities that we put one beside the others, and we just had to understand things. On the contrary, let's go inside a studio and see what happens. And it was an extraordinary experience, to use a word that I will insist on. It is to live something in the present. And that was exactly the job of people there. Physically, the studio is the idea of cutting people from the existing world around and putting together people, material, devices, in the same place, scores, even music instruments, and see what happens. So it doesn't mean all these guys and ladies have the same knowledge and specialty. On the contrary, it's precisely because the idea of the studio was to mix all that and giving words to everybody and even everything, so the sounds were important, that made things happen. It's interesting compared to classical music, because the score was very made with a pencil in the end, corrected all the time and so on. And with their competencies. People are not a stick. Well, I'm a sound engineer, so I only speak of sound. On the contrary, they were getting out of their own competencies to be able to make a hit happen. Of course, no security at all. And an interesting thing was to get out of the studio, because then we follow the same experience as music itself. It's not because it's out of the studio that it's done. They make it listen to everybody. All professionals well known, but also the secretary there, people, friends that come in the studio. And time by time, experience by experience, little details by little details, something is coming out. So on the, I was not studying rock music, in fact, it was really what we call in France, variété, which is a strange name to say popular music. And so songs in on the TV, no, success is not produced because of economical calculation that would say, oh, this pleases to the people, let's have it and it will be done. It's a kind of this opposing classical music. It was a work, collective, heterogeneous, done by people gathered in the same places with collective devices and looking, making exist more present time. I use this little emphatic expression, making more present, because it's exactly the linkage that I can make jumping over 30 or 40 years in my own experience with what I read in James, probably in a selective way, because he's often quoted for other kind of thing, but it's not a philosophy of the present. It's more something like a claim on this present that is the only thing we can experience. And this idea that it's kind of philosophy of music, that's what I would try to develop and starting on quite contrasted cases. Music as something that is always to be done. It was formulated by philosophers, but by using a formulation that I don't like, that is opposing autographic, Danto, for instance, autographic and allographic works. So statues are fixed, music is only passing, or an art of the time, to say that. I think it's a weak formulation of this importance given to the present as being not a point, but on the contrary, the only, like a kind of condensated relationship between many heterogeneous things. So music doesn't exist, not in the sense, that it would be a kind of illusion, but in the sense that it's always something to be done, is important, as I will develop afterward, about historical music of the past, but nothing is more present than making actual music of the past. But it's also the idea that it's not that much opposed to any other object. I mean, even a statue if you don't look at it, if it's not put in a museum, if it's not explained by a lot of cartoons, and if it's not part of your own history, you don't just see it. I mean, any object has to be born again, has to be made present collectively, technically, and personally to exist. The interest of music is that this experience, precise the thing, is not only the present, it's the fact that everything is in the present, but that it's not at all in opposition with training, trained bodies, lots of past experiences. I mean, it's obvious in the case of music. Any pianist that comes on the stage in a concert hall is very Jamesian. I mean, there is nothing but the present act. That's why his hands are a little shaking. I mean, of course it doesn't oppose to the past. It's because I've played and played and played again this Beethoven sonata or any piece of music or even improvisation. I will come back to that. It's not in spite of that. It's because of that, that I'm present here with all this kind of layers of experimentations, of past experimentation that I have to make actual. I underline the word actual because it has not the same meaning in French and in English, and the difference is exactly at the core of my argument today. It's in French, we say actuel to say present, even in a poor sense of l'actualité, the things that are in the newspaper today. And in fact, in English, actual means made. I mean, actual means present, and the Latin words mean it's an action. It's an action to be, let's say, present to the present. It also means that the present is not always the same, of course. Sometimes James was making some development. Sometimes it's just loose and full of nearly nothing. And sometimes it's very dense. It's Roland Garros now in the tennis. I think the guy that is in his set, in the end of the set, winning or losing his match for one ball, he knows what it is. Sportsmen know very well this idea of a philosophy of the presence. It's now with everything that is there, and it won't be the same again at any moment. So, from this idea of music as something that is a kind of case to present this idea of it's a complicated idea, in fact, if we develop it, of there is nothing but the present experience, is interesting because of its very strong links to the past. There is only the present, but more and more, we mostly listen to music from the past. What would seem contradictory is not contradictory at all. Listening to something today is making in new ways, in always renewed modes, fashions, what has been done, which was not the same thing. There are several layers of, in this quite complicated knot that I put around my own neck. So I will try to develop that by using in a little maybe opportunistic way of using another author who is De Certeau. It's also a kind of act of fidelity, of recognition, because when I wrote on Baroque music or on Bach, the author outside of music that I had in mind was not yet James, or later Souriot, that I will give a word about him too. But it was De Certeau, because, especially because of the guy, he was invited in the CSI for 2 years when he was when he came back from San Diego and had no position in Paris. Thank you, friends. So we welcomed him in CSI, where we were quite far from his thematics, but that was the moment where he was writing L'écriture de l'histoire. Writing, I don't know, it's translated into English, I should have checked, writing history, or the scribing of history. And it's an extraordinary book, because it's very personal, and in spite, I don't think it only mentions in any place the name of William James or pragmatism in general, very far from the French tradition, except some Deleuzian moments. But he was, in historical terms, saying exactly the same, not saying exactly the same, I didn't know people do that, but going, searching exactly in the same direction. Writing the past, writing about the past, was not at all saying what has been done 2 centuries ago. L'écriture de l'histoire means making things past. English is, and French have not the same grammar at all. So I would say that in insisting on making things past, means transforming them actually, presently, both actually and presently, in fact, to make them exist through scribing them, writing them down. So the idea that there's the history, writing history, is not going back into the past, but on the contrary, from the absence of the past, making it exist today, was the center, nothing to do with music, was the center of his theory of history, écrire sur une absence, writing in the absence of something, and thus making it present for us, a kind of present past, if it was not a time, a grammatical state. When we have in mind Johann Sebastian Bach, this idea of this conception of writing history takes an incredible suggestivity, capacity of making us understand much better what it is to listen, experience, live music today. Because we realize that there's absolutely nothing common between them and us. I mean, instead of continuously researching what was the real score than Bach was writing on his paper, and have it more and more faithfully exactly what it was in the past time, which should be, it could be a kind of the false definition of musicologists' work, we are making, I would say, exactly the opposite experimentation. We, concert by concert, writing by writing, make more present the music of Bach precisely because we make more and more researches on what happened then and how did they play, which kind of instrument they use, how many people were in the... But are we doing that in the same world than Johann Sebastian Bach one? Not at all. It's even caricatural. I mean, he was rewriting continuously things that had already been written, not at all to make the Bach's work catalog, but to have people pray God in a church. It's so. We listen to Bach as the father of all music, having learned every note of his scores through scores and through recordings from our teenage, if we play the piano or learn music in general. We have in the ear hundreds of different versions of the same music, in the sense that what is written in this, on the score. Our experience of listening to Bach is 100%, I would even say 115% present, modern. It's completely made from our contemporary experience of what music is. And reciprocally, we mostly constructed this modern experience of classical and even larger musics from this work that has been done on Bach for all the centuries that separate him from us. So, works that were taken from other pieces, even French composers, cantata written some years ago with for a precise day and a religious purpose, without the idea of that it would be played again, or which is nearly the same with the idea that it could be rewritten, reused for another purpose by a composer that was tortured by religious issues, and now the specialists are seeing that it was a kind of strange mixture of pietism and more esoteric tendency of the German Protestantism of the time. To understand better what I'm trying to say, there is a very good case that I'm even a little surprised that with all the pages and pages that have been written on Bach, and Bach in French, has not been underlined that much. In 1724 or 3, controversy, Bach's give is a Matthäus Passion in Leipzig. And in every little book on Bach, we say the bourgeois of the time were shocked and say, what's that? It's an opera, and the lady is supposed to have vanished from the violence of this music. And then we say in a very modernist way, so this bourgeois, so stupid as every bourgeois, of course, is didn't understand the genius of Bach. And so we, the modern, are the only one that understands him, and we progressively discovered the greatness of the man. I have another interpretation of this strange event that probably indeed made partially our modern music beginning to exist, I would say, in a kind of provocative way. Because my interpretation, I worked with Denis Laborde, a musicologist, on that question, and doesn't fully agree with my interpretation. And I worked with Joël Marie Fouquet on a book on Bach in France in 19th century to follow up this idea. It's not that the bishop of the church made a kind of a reprimand, of a punishing nearly to Bach. It's that Bach himself was wondering about what he was doing. He was a religious man wondering if putting on a scene the Christ's death, have I not gone too far away? Have I made of the passion of Christ a spectacle? What my music is for? So when I'm on an organ and I, or choral, and I help people understand better God's words, I'm making my job. If I play such a rich music that people are afraid or see that like music, probably I make a mistake. Why do I say that? Because then the point that is not often underscored in books and back, it's that from 1725 to 1750, that's 25 years. No religious music any longer. Not completely. A Catholic mass, which for a Protestant is something a little bizarre. Maybe he cared less about profanating the word of God if it was for Catholics. Beautiful music made of past, some cantatas, mostly retaken from old cantatas. You say, okay, you said just before that he was always retaking. No, even I read a musicologist Basso, who precisely feels that it's not the same way of retaking. Now, he's not reusing always this kind of music coming from himself and from others to make music again, like before. Now he really takes a piece and put it there. So it's a kind of, to me, it's a kind of a way of saying, no, I mean, I can prove that. I've been too far. I should now do more modestly, as a kind of resignation or even with a feeling of defeat over I've done something wrong. But what I do well is writing music, because it doesn't mean he didn't know he was an excellent composer. We say his fights with Telemann or shows it. What I know is to write music now, more modestly, I will be a teacher of music, a music teacher. And that's what he does afterwards. Art of the Fugue, musical offering, organs, extraordinary pieces that are made to learn music. And so the paradox I was underlying, in his time, he was in a way renouncing of his mission of being in music the spokesperson of God, probably feeling that he's been made a sin of proudness, and getting down one or two steps, I'll only be a modest teacher. But then, being a modest teacher, he launches the way we understand Bach. And so that's why my book with Fouquet on Bach was not in Germany, not in 18th century, not in 20th century, but for Bach in 19th century in another country, which means how did we progressively made both of Bach, the father of all musicians, and of music itself, our main concern in Bach's work. So he was doing an excellent music to honor God. Now we think that somebody that is so concerned by God must make a really good music, and we like him for his music, not for God. So it's a complete inversion of the relationship between Bach and us. Why 19th century? Because then, instead of having this strange retroactive way of saying we are now more and more knowing about Bach and more confident in our historical way of having understood everything of him, and it's true technically, it's completely false musically, aesthetically. We are in a world made by Bach, or made, but what we made with Bach and from his hands in books like, in works like Fugue, Art of the Fugue. But we progressively, and especially in 19th century, invented a new world of music. And it's incredibly suggestive when we see what works of Bach was known even at the end of 19th century, nearly nothing. Even the Matthäus Passion, it was some short pieces given, of course, on a big symphonic orchestra and with opera voices. And people knew the well-tempered clavier and studying it. And some pieces were given in the beginning of the century, of the 19th century, is well known as an old teacher. Somebody that if you learn music, you can read a score and learn a counterpoint and a fuga, and of course, make your own music. Progressive, it was very late that people took him as a contemporary composer. I say that in a kind of provocative way, but it's to stress the change of mood. It's because we, has to be developed, we progressively made exist an art music with its own rules, that progressively Bach become the father of this reality he didn't know at all, very, very far from that. It doesn't only concern Bach, of course, Fouquet precisely. We dated in Paris at around the 80s or 85, the moment where there were in concert more music from the past than music from the present composed for the concert. It's a very recent experience coming especially from the quatuor little amateurs. I will come back on that too if I have the time. That was something like the invention of music. So you see this completely retroactive way we have to go further and further in an obsessive way of knowing everything of a composer. And now if you're a Bach amateur, you know all the catalogue of the Bach Werke Verzeichnis, which was which is something that is coming only in the middle of the 20th century. And it depends on the record industry, and it depends on our level of classical music. So we're in a world that has nothing in common. I exaggerate a little. Yes, all the links we progressively made to him. And that's what it means, that Bach, as the rest, is only a present moment. It's funny because I studied, of course, the for la passion musicale, the passion for music. I took, for example, this marginal change of mode, which was funny, a modern way of replaying Baroque music. So who is modern? The ones who play Couperin on piano, or the ones that are playing it back the way they were playing it at that time. But playing something the way it was played at that time, nothing is more modern than that. Of course, playing it in the mood, in the musical mood of our time, with a piano and in a concert beside Schumann and Brahms, that was the way of the time. And it kept on in the same direction till now, because after now, nearly 50 years after the Baroque revival, every 2 years, there is a new way of playing Baroque music. You know, and now the mode is to play it much faster than most of tempo, of course, faster than Klemperer in the Matthaus, but even compared to Leonhardt and the Harnoncourt 50 years ago, now Pichon in France, other ones elsewhere, they're playing Bach's cantatas like dances, very fast. The number of course, it's open because research is sometimes bring something new, sometimes are contested or reinterpreted, which is nothing is more present than looking at old scores and trying to take it another way. I go back to another aspect of this case of Bach that I sometimes pronounce Bach at the French way, or sometimes Bach if I try to look more musical. It's also this Soli Deo Gloria thing. It's funny because even specialists of Bach make a translation of that as a gift, which is also present in some scholar. To the glory, I offer that to the glory of God. But the SDG that is written on every score of Bach is not at all the idea that I, the composer, genial artist, am offering my work to God. It's not that at all. Soli Deo Gloria. I'm not a composer. I'm just a servant of God. Adieu seul la gloire means that the glory of my own music comes from God, which of course gives a completely different weight, I would say, to this moment of the Matthäus Passion. I was extrapolating Adieu seul la gloire. Did I commit a blasphemy, in fact, by putting my work so sophisticated and theatrically presentation? Wasn't I becoming an author? That would be an anachronic way of depicting, analyzing this moment of crisis that I alone Dubac. It's a decisive moment for composer, because looking, for instance, at Tia de Nora's book on Beethoven, young Tia de Nora's one, it would not be the same question at all for Beethoven, who explicitly, on the contrary, against the princes, against the bourgeois, against his masters and the payers, say, no, I'm making my music, and he does it in music too. He changes the rule. It's that you'll understand it in 50 years. You see Bach saying, you'll understand my music in 50 years, when the violin in the quatuor that were saying, but what is it, this music? Don't mind, you will understand in 50 years. So in a very short time, what was in question there was the beginning of the invention of our modern conception of music. And it has taken place nearly one century after Bach's ordinary right. The other, I know how much time I have, the other track I wanted to follow shouldn't be the other one. I took the case of Bach because it's very suggestive, but as you may have understood, I was not speaking of Bach himself. I was speaking of this present heterogeneous reality that include our taste for Bach. And this taste for Bach and for anything else is the other side of the same middle. It's the invention of amateurship. It's too bad amateurs has been the word, the French word amateur has been taken into English, because it means not professional. It also means that in French, but it also means a great amateur of wine is not a non-professional. It's somebody that really learned to like things. And what I mentioned, what I developed mostly regarding in the direction of Bach himself, was in a way also as much a way of putting the spotlight on the invention of the amateur. And then it's not only Bach. We see very quickly the changes, for instance, in 19th century France and England, which is the leading country more than Germany at that time, where progressively and little by little, details by details, everything that will be our model of classical music has to be invented, really. So there are two main tracks for this inauguration of the concert hall. One is quite Beethovenian. It's the invention of small circles of amateurs, very selective, very musicians, high society, very conscious of being higher than the other, begins to take music seriously. And this is very new. I mean, when you compare with what we incorrectly called concerts at the time, concert were the program, but the concert were not concert at all. It were the people speaking between them, eating, and some musician on the corner, like in a cafe now, nobody listening to them, or the opera. And the opera was everything but listening to an opera. It was a very mundane moment where all the good society was going. It was part of the game. Opera, it's not for nothing, because is it Is it art music or is it popular spectacle? The resort of the pleasure of opera, the voice, the donna and the tenor, love, the story, the theatrical, the theater part of it. All that makes it a very heterogeneous performance, very, very adapted to the naissance of the bourgeoisie in 19th century, that was writing his own story. Now French opera is considered as less good, forgotten. 19th century French opera is considered as second range music compared to Italian real operas for the voice and Wagner for seriousness. And it was a light music. It's completely false, I mean. La Muette de Portici, Les Huguenots, and Protestants at Saint-Barthélemy put the massacre of Protestants put on a scene. La Juive, made by Halévy, Jewish himself. The French bourgeoisie was going to the opera to define itself. Nation, power, it's a king, a love, personal, our personal feelings against power. I mean, it was a mise en scène, really, of the political issues of the bourgeoisie and a way of forging it, even as a kind of a social class, I think, from Fulcher in music to Elias and more general. It's the invention of the bourgeoisie, not as we are the bourgeois against the other, but we are the model class. And opera has an importance for that enormous. But it means that still in 1880, the room, the hall, there was light in the hall and people were getting up and going out of the scene. It's a mixture of Wagnerianism and anti-Wagnerianism in France that progressively made opera something that we are looking at in silence on a scene, looking at it as if it was a quatuor, what the other had invented in their small club, in a silent room, in the black, and of course, with the applause and shouting after the air. You go in Italy still now, you often have the real opera as it was in Italy in the 19th century, with people making noise during the spectacles, nearly singing, applauding before the end of tunes and so on. So I mostly underline the musical part of it, but you can understand that all the technical part of it, that is recording, analyzing musicologically, making catalogs, having scores organized, schools that learn music from old masters. We collectively constructed for two centuries the world of classical music, in which, still moving now, in which we make all this past author something completely present, which was the as you may guess, the key argument of my paper. I don't know how long is, I don't remember how long is supposed to be my talk, because the other part on amateur may be a little too long. Derek will say me no. Well, I can briefly say my argument and we can talk together afterwards. After the passion for music, as often when we write books, we understand at the end of the book what was the purpose and it becomes the following books. And in fact, La Passion Musicale, passion for music, was the simple idea of this experience I was talking about in the beginning. That was instead of looking at all the mediations that make music, the main thing was to realize in the both meaning of the term, that there's no music outside of somebody liking music. So it's not at the end of the chain when you have studied all the composers, interpreters, catalogs, and you would look now at the end of the public and who listens to that. It's completely linear model, is completely outside the game. What is invented when we rewrite Bach on, or we produce records is to develop, make thinner and thinner, more complicated and more complicated, the experience that is liking music. And this is an invention too. So it's not at all a second side of the of my talk. It's more the idea that studying, I did that for a time, one by one, how some precise people manage their way of liking, listening, collecting music is the place where musical experience exists. And it was a very pleasant way of having a very, very heterogeneous and anything but conformist modes of appreciating music. I just give an example, if I must conclude now. It's a guy, a French guy, that was from Algerian origin, knowing nothing about classical music, and in couple with a French girl who was a classical music fan. He was working in Lyon and staying in Paris, and she gave him pieces of cassette at that time, small pieces of music for the train. And the guy was saying me, I explicitly, also it was not easy to write, or therefore not each time, and he didn't want to know the names, and invented his way of listening to classical music linked to the train. So not knowing at all if it was 18th, 16th century, and what is it? I just tried to listen to what happens in my train. And he said, now I can't hear music, classical music, without seeing trees moving in the window. And it's a great pleasure connected to my former girlfriend. And it's my experience of music. I collected hundreds of examples, more or less sophisticated as this one, to open up this box of what it is to be a music amateur, not at all as just adding sold records in a bookshop, but as ways of making music, it's his own, one's own music each time we play it.